Good afternoon, everyone. Before I start my talk, I see Dr. Sarvanan sir sitting in the audience. Your comment on first talk, sir. You want to add on something or sure? Because that is more important. This OCT and all is for us. But a physician role in managing diabetic retinopathy as well as general referral, that is more critical for us. You want to add anything? Okay. Later. Okay. Thanks. So we move on to OCT, how we can make it simpler, and also what are the intravitreal injections available to us and how to choose. No financial interest in my talk. Scenarios like this in regular OPDs are becoming quite commoner for us, where we see and we even doubt whether you want to treat right eye of this patient. But the OCT per se has changed the way we look at all this patient. We all know what OCT stands for and how it works for us and what are the principles of OCTs and what are the evolution over a period of time. But what you also need to keep in mind is diabetic macular edema, which is a sight-threatening disease for a particular patient, has various subtypes, and we are even evolving and learning on these subtypes of which will behave which way and what are the associations as well for that particular patient. So when we look at all this complex disease, does angiogram still has a role? Comes the first question. I will say still angiogram has a role in guiding clinically significant macular edema. Toilet, sometimes unexplained visual loss. Sometimes you also do as a baseline and unexpected, non-clinically you've seen neovascularization. So this patient has a CME which is diffuse in nature and needs an angiogram basically to start treatment on. Again, diffuse DME not so seen severely clinically, but when you do an angiogram, you also see good amount of cystoid macular edema, though it can be also picked up on OCT. But these kind of things where you are not certain that how much of exudation is there and how much of leakage is there, better to get an angiogram also done as well. And special scenarios, though OCTA has changed the way we look at ischemic retina, especially in diabetic macular edema and diabetic retinopathy, but still angiogram has a role. So it is not that we have thrown out this machine. We still have a couple of challenging scenarios like asteroid. But the way OCT has changed in understanding this disease, as you have a focal edema, which is easily treatable with intravitreal. This is immediately post-treatment. And also the diffuse DME per se has been reclassified and classified on and on again because like spongiform, early spongiform, with a massive spongiform thickening, presence or absence of neurosensory detachment and so on. So diffuse DME with large cyst like this will require repeated session of treatment. There is also disruption of inner and outer retinal layers here, more of a schisis, as we can see here. I'm sorry, the pointer is not working, so we have to work with the mouse. And then you have a presence or absence of a subfoveal detachment, which indicates sometimes chronic kidney disease. So this patient may require a period treatment over a long period of time. This was the same patient with post-injection, the OCT is flat. But we often get rebound. So here comes the role of an endocrinologist or a good diabetologist to work on with us as to make sure that this patient's systemic parameters, including diabetes, hypertension, lipid to some extent, are well controlled, and especially kidney functions test as well. This is a patient who has early spongiform thickening here as well as some exudation in the outer retina here. But this patient sometimes the rebound treatment after anti-VEGF or maybe steroid in certain cases, the rebounds are somewhere worse where the systemic status is not under control. So this patient, you can see here, start a minimum intravitreal pharmacotherapy, but the systemic status was not under good control, so the rebound was quite bad. So these are the situations where we are dealing with, as you treat only on the OCT based or you treat patient as a whole is a $1 million question. I think you should go with the second one thought, that you treat patient as a whole, don't treat it only the scan, as most of all not, we have seen patients carrying just an OCT printout, so this thickness is less, this thickness is more, but still I'm not getting any visual benefit. So there's another example of spongiform thickness with an intraretinal cyst formation here, as well as tractional, which can be easily minimized if the traction is early, like in this picture, with a subfoveal exudates, denotes poorer response for any type of treatment. Fine amount of vitromacular traction can easily be missed with a clinical examination, so the OCT gives us quite an understanding of this problem. And this kind of multiplanar traction, I'm sorry, the scan has been cut. But you have a multiplanar traction here, starting from the vitreous to the epiretinal membrane on the surface to intraretinal cyst, and also you can see here there is a neurosensory detachment of the retina. This is a clear-cut case of a vitrectomy. No way this patient is going to benefit with your pharmacotherapy. Sometimes if the media is hazy, still you can pick up quite a fair amount of foveal tracts status, as this patient has a TRD involving fovea and will require a surgical intervention. This was a patient post-vitrectomy, developed a secondary ARM and early macular edema. As well as in challenging scenarios like we have asteroid, we can pick up the traction with quite great extent. So how do we do analysis of a particular OCT scan? We normally believe in quantitative as well as qualitative analysis. What do I mean by that? We look at the start from the vitromacular interface, look at the thickness of the retina, the changes in the inner retinal layer, outer retinal layer, and also at the photoreceptor level. We just don't look at the thickness in terms of numbers. We look at the entire morphology of the OCT scan. So like this, you study the entire morphology of the OCT scan, see what's happening clinically as well to the retina, and then only do your decision making. Don't just interpret one scan of this printout. Also, the way we are having the choices available to us from macular line to macular class, multimacular scans, EDI, enhanced imaging, SDI, everything is changing over a period of time. So we are not just looking at one particular scan. We need to sit with the OCT machine, go through the entire scan of the retina, and then take the decisions. The indications are quite numerous. I cannot go into details. But what I want to tell is, like, sometimes the morphological changes can also play quite a significant role. This is the OCT classification of different layers, as how to interpret what are the reflectivity of different structures. Color coding is always a pseudo color coding, so we don't give too much of importance to that. However, sometimes there is a pathological reflectivity, like in this picture here, there is a ERM, there is a cotton wool spot here which mimics a hemorrhage. So you need a clinical correlation as well. And the hemorrhage, if at all it is there, is most commonly not what we used to think is always sub-hyaloid hemorrhage, is mostly a sub-ILM hemorrhage, where the treatment changes considerably here. So all these things has to be looked into carefully with OCT. This is a common presentation, as we see OCT is most commonly like this, where you have intraretinal edema, hemorrhages, and the heart exudate sitting right there, and we don't know how to go about the treatment. So the pharmacotherapy does play a role, but which agent to choose when is a thing which we have to use judiciously. This kind of large cysts, they do respond to pharmacotherapy quite well. However, importance of the systemic control is also equally important. The things which were changing over a period of time, from the identifying the retinal layers, we are also trying to identify the markers, the biomarkers which can be easily seen on the OCT, what can predict a good amount of visual acuity change with treatment over a period of time. So these are the common findings which we have already discussed. This kind of finer planar tractions has also been looked into it, and we should not be missed in any patient when you are doing a careful OCT scan. ERMs, something like a broad-based ERMs, can easily be picked and studied, and we can even delineate the planar traction from which where you are going to attempt a traction release for this particular patient. And also fibrovascular proliferation over a period of time, we have realized that OCT gives us enough information and we don't need angiograms for this patient. Also, if the patient has active NVE, that also can be easily picked up. NVD as well, this example shows the patient has a florid NVD here, and which can be easily picked up over a period with OCT scan. So this kind of smaller changes in the neurosensory retina here, that is a neurosensory elevation, also indicates some kind of poor prognosis, but these patients do respond to treatment. So what are the treatment algorithms? We have seen that in DME per se, when you look at the pathophysiology, we have a role of inflammation, neovascularization, and vascular leakage. So all three are playing a part as compared to uveitis, vein occlusions, and AMD. So here the benefit of treatment from steroids, from anti-VEGF, and the combination does play a role. So when we understand these pathologies, the things have changed over a period of time as classification, which I've already told. Investigative modalities, mainly we are relying only on OCT, and what are the treatment options. So this was ETDRS, which we normally don't follow now. We mostly follow either a clinical presence or absence of diabetic macular edema, which is center involving or non-center involving, and also OCT based, which can be even morphological in nature. So these are the 5 to 6 subtypes: focal, cystoid, diffuse edema, neurosensory detached feature, not a OCT based feature. So we see here presence or absence of edema, right, involving the foveal center, or if it is not involving the foveal center. If it is not involving the foveal center, the treatment is still laser. If it is involving the foveal center, then you have plethora of treatment options available. What has changed, and what even I think Dr. Ashish is going to share with us, is imaging to the next level. What is the role of wild field, and also what is the role of non-responders on imaging. So the guiding principles is, first you classify the DME as in central involving, non-central involving. Look for the good glycemic control of these patients, including blood pressure, serum lipids, anemia if at all present. And as of now, anti-VEGFs we know are the first line of choice of treatment, but there are select groups where we need to go on alternative treatment. When to switch over from anti-VEGF, either to laser or steroid, either in non-responders, and this is this case, this is ascitic edema, may respond better to steroid than as anti-VEGF alone. For non-center DME, definitely laser still has a role. A normal green laser will suffice for this. OCT and vision are the key tests for determining your treatment outcome. However, we don't give too much of importance to vision as of now. Even the 6-6 patients warrant treatment if there is a significance of treatment on your clinical examination. And vitromacular traction changes your perspective of thinking about surgical intervention for these patients over a period of time. So how do we apply these principles? We have a patient who has bilaterally visually significant diabetic macular edema with a fairly good vision, but we do an angiogram, we see multiple leaks. This patient also has a leak here, which is a CSR leak in nature. So we are not only looking at the diabetic macular edema. This kind of subtle findings can be missed on easily on clinical examination, as you can go back and see the picture here again, which was missed by me on clinical examination. But when I did a baseline angiogram, I picked up the CSR, and this patient also had a fair amount of diabetic macular edema after getting intensive control of diabetes. This is the post treatment in form of anti-VEGF with laser, and you can see over a period of time when we persisted with treatment, a clean looking retina, which has resolved over a period of time, giving the edema has resolved over a period of time, giving good visual acuity for this patient. Another scenario, which is one of the most commonest scenario nowadays, it's actually rare to see any kind of a phakic lens in any patient. Normally we see all patients who are pseudophakic, but you have a cataract, you don't give too importance only to the cataract, you will do a careful retinal examination. And this patient received focal laser elsewhere, which has not turned up to the mark, and there was also a fair amount of traction which was missed on clinical examination elsewhere. When we did an angiogram for this patient, I see a lot of periphobial leaks here, but also the traction which was there at the surface of retina warrants some surgical intervention at some point of time. So you explain this to the patient clearly, and also keep the same thing in back of your mind. Now the question here arises, whether you go ahead only with monotherapy or a combination therapy, and when do you time your cataract surgery, and what are the retreatment schedules. Another case where you have ischemic macula, patient having renal failure with uncontrolled diabetes and hypertension. This is also one of the common scenarios. This patient was even asthmatic, and the angiogram was contraindicated, though not required in this case. Again, not a well lasered eye, but you see clinically the visual acuity was quite poor in the left eye, stating ischemia, and also the macular edema was quite significant, which warranted treatment. So this patient was a clear candidate that the intravitreal steroid will be a better choice of treatment rather than anti-VEGF. Another case where I started my discussion with, this lady has uncontrolled diabetes over a period of time. Right eye was debatable whether you want to treat or not to treat. However, when explaining the prognosis, the patient was quite motivated for treatment. Started the treatment right in 2012 April. Multiple sessions of anti-VEGF were given along with steroid and the laser. She also developed choroidal neovascular membrane in due course of time in spite of treatment in the right eye, which is also known But when we persisted with treatment, this patient got benefit over a period of time by means combination of steroid, laser and anti-VEGF. And what you see here with persistence of treatment, though the right eye didn't benefit much visually, but there was a structural improvement. But the left eye almost started becoming near normal, and this also exudation resolved over a period of time after treatment. So the persistence is again key here, both from the physicians, ophthalmologists, as well as the patient. That also has to be clearly explained to the patient. Do we have a role of steroids in diabetic macular edema in today's scenario, where steroids are the first line of choice of treatment, though it is not approved? We do have a couple of scenarios where in clinical situation where the anti-VEGF has to be avoided, where effect seems to be similar with anti-VEGF, so that we can prolong the duration of treatment as 1 month as compared to 3 to 4 months. Where there seems to be some benefit of steroids over anti-VEGF, some examples I'll show you. And are there anti-VEGF non-responders in DME as well, though not known? So couple of scenarios where we have pregnancy, history of recent stroke, history of MI, recent vitrectomy, we feel steroids, especially the dexamethasone implant, works better here. And treatment, what about treatment knee-wise? So there seems to be some benefit, as been shown by Rise and Ride as well as Biverdex study in subgroup analysis, that the steroids in select group of patients work better for diabetic macular edema as anti-VEGF. And when you don't have a good amount of vitreous sump for the drug to be absorbed, so that if there is a scenario, then steroid has a better penetration and better role. This kind of intractable hard if respond better to steroid. Do we have tachyphylaxis? Not so common reported in diabetic macular edema. But there are also a lot of emerging trends, especially when we understand the epidemiology and the prevalence of diabetic retinopathy. And also these are going to tell us that future treatment directions as well. So we are also learning and evolving over a period of time. And this was the consensus-based, evidence-based diabetic macular edema management given by our Indian group, published in AIOC2018 in 2016, also has given us insights on how multidisciplinary approach is better. Then there was a survey by the ASRS where they have clearly shown whether how many injections are required, and the survey clearly says that the number of injections in non-responder or poorly responder over a period of time for diabetic macular edema are coming down. So we are looking for an alternative treatment in these patients, and not only with monotherapy alone. And what we have the current understanding, if you just tell me to summarize it, we should have a non-center involving macular edema, then focal laser. If there is a central involvement, phakic patient prefer anti-VEGF. Center involving diffuse edema, pseudophakic anti-VEGF or steroid can be chosen over a period of based on the physician and the patient's discretion. Center involving neurosensory detachment, phakic, pseudophakic, anti-VEGF or steroid again can be debatable. You can choose either. Diabetic macular edema PDR anti-VEGF has a role. However, this PDR should be non-tractional in nature to start on with. Vitrectomy eyes steroids scores better, as well as in pregnant ladies. Recent history of stroke or a CVI, steroids have a role to play here. And recalcitrant cases, we always look for vitrectomy as an option, plus minus injection of intravitreal pharmacotherapeutic agents. So equally important is your systemic status, lens status and perfusion status of the retina, classification and also the financial status of the patient in Indian scenarios. Visual acuity, no more a criteria. FFA still has a role in select cases. However, I do still do a baseline FFA in most of my patients, unless and until it is contraindicated. OCT at repeated intervals is the way to look forward, and we are at the combination of combination treatment modality zone. This kind of patients which have center involvement or non-central involvement in macular edema can easily be managed and treated with a fair amount of improvement in visual acuity. So we are not only talking about injections, not about switching always, not about algorithms. We're also talking about a personalized approach for each and every patient. We have so many trials available, but when you come to real-time situation for that particular patient, we also need to see that blindness is due to diabetes is preventable. And diabetes is a disease which can only be controlled but cannot be cured. So that also has to be put across. And we are privileged to have good physicians like you, sir, to share the approach with us, where you have the prime role, we are at the secondary role, and so that ultimate care to the patient can be given. Lot of ophthalmologically new agents are going to come, which will change the way we are treating as of now in 5 to 7 years' time. So the take-home message is laser still has a role. Think of combination therapy in most often of the scenarios, and also systemic parameters have to be given due importance. When we think about pharmacotherapy, we have anti-VEGF and steroid to choose. However, economics also play a role. OCT has to be studied for each and every individual patient with a tailor-made approach, and give due importance to your clinical examination and understanding your patient needs, which will help you in crucially in making good decision making for that particular patient.